are stories about what happened.
It's true. All of it.
Hey guys, Brian from the Star Wars Canon Library, and you heard the man, there were stories. And they're all true. My name's Brian. I'm the librarian here at the Canon Library, where we're keeping all the canon in chronological order for you guys. Guys, welcome to the second episode of Mailbag for the Star Wars Canon Library. After the first episode, I actually got quite a few emails asking questions, and I decided to try to keep it at about six that I was going to answer. So last week I did seven, just because the seventh one, for those of you that watched, it was a subject that I feel like needed touched on, and some things needed to be said. So I went ahead and did seven last week, but this week I'm only going to do six, and I've got six questions picked out. How do you guys get a question on the Star Wars Canon Library? You simply email it to StarWarsCanonLibrary@gmail.com. I'll go through and pick out ones that, you know, may seem relevant to what may be going on at the time, or, you know, something that hasn't been touched on before that we haven't talked about, or, you know, something like that. So go ahead and send those questions in, guys, and I may get lucky and get one on. So without further ado, let's just jump right into this, shall we? Now, this may be a little bit of a shorter episode. I'm not feeling real great tonight. Had to have Kirsty bring me some sugar at work today. So I'm not feeling real great, but got to do Mailbag Monday. So here we go, guys. Question number one. Let's just dive right into this. And the question number one comes from Nicholas Reeves. And Nicholas asks, when do you think we'll get the trailer for the Han Solo movie? That's an excellent question. Considering the film is, you know, 6 months out, and we've got Last Jedi coming up, I'm one of those people that firmly believes it's going to be attached to the Last Jedi. In my mind, it makes the most sense, mainly because you've got your target audience right there in the cinema, getting ready to watch the Last Jedi, right? Those are the people who you want to go see Han Solo. Those are the people that are probably going to go see Han Solo anyway, but this is a great way to put the trailer out. Which means if that's what they do, they'll probably release the trailer that week, maybe a day or two before online. So I'm going to say sometime next week where they're going to drop the trailer online. And if they do, then it's definitely going to be attached to The Last Jedi. Now, we're 6 months out from the film. They did the same thing with Infinity War last week. They dropped the trailer, and that was about 6 months before the film. So Han Solo opens, I think, a week or two after Infinity War. So if we get the trailer a week or two after the Infinity War trailer, that math's going to make sense. But that's if they stick to the same equation for both movies. I don't know if they're going to do that or not. But I definitely think the trailer is going to be attached to The Last Jedi. I could be wrong. It could come out shortly afterwards. But I part of me just has this gut feeling. Call it a disturbance in the force, if you would. But I really think that it's going to drop with The Last Jedi. So thanks for the question, Nick. Question number two comes from Richard J. And anybody who follows the channel for any amount of time knows that Richard J. is a very avid follower of the page. And he had a little bit of a complicated question, and really a simple question if you think about it. But Richard J. asks, at the end of the best film in the Lucas-directed saga, fact, it did gross the most worldwide. He's talking about The Phantom Menace. Senator Palpatine turns to Anakin at the end of the movie and tells him, and you, young Skywalker, we will watch your career with great interest. Do you think Palpatine had any knowledge of what was to come, or was this just a flippant political remark? Thanks for the question, Jay. It's a really good question, and I think there's two answers to this. The first answer is the simple one, and I'm going to start with that one. The first answer, I think, when Episode 1 came out, it was just a nice little nod to what we know is going to happen later in the future, because we knew where the prequels were going to end up. It had a certain point. It had to get to A New Hope. So we knew where that was going to go, and I think that was mainly just a little bit of an Easter egg as a little nod to, like, I see what you're talking about there. I see where that's going. So I think that's what it was originally meant to be. Now that we have this giant world of canon, if you got to look at it in like a canonical, is that how you say it? Canonical? A canonical context. At the time, Palpatine, because I don't think Palpatine had anything to do. I'm not one of these people that thinks Palpatine had anything to do with Anakin's birth. I don't think he even knew about Anakin until he came onto the scene. But you got to think about what was going on with Anakin, what happened with him, his situation, and the Chancellor obviously heard about it. It's this 9-year-old kid that they found in the middle of nowhere. that has more midichlorian count. Yeah, I said midichlorians. I'm sorry. They are canon. I don't like them either, but I digress. It has a midichlorian count more than the Grandmaster of the Order, Yoda. You've got all these star pilots from Naboo that go to take out the droid control ship, and then you've got this 9-year-old kid who just accidentally flies into the ship and destroys it. Accidentally, right? He's that powerful with the Force, and then, you know, Palpatine's got to be sitting here thinking, this guy remembers his mother, he's been accepted into the Order late, he's going to have issues with that, this could work to my advantage. I may have a new apprentice on the horizon. I think after he heard the story, he sat back and he was thinking, this could happen. Oh man, I got to change my plans a little bit, you know, because he even tells Grievous after Dooku's dead, you know, he's like, you know, soon I'll have a new apprentice, one far younger and more powerful. So I think that's what he was going for the entire time, and it just, that's the way Sidious's plan worked out. So I think it started off as just an Easter egg, as a nod, and ended up having a deeper meaning the further we got into the canon. So thanks for the question, Dave. It was a really good one. Third question comes from Christina Fry. I think it's Fry. I went to high school with somebody whose last name was spelled the same as yours, so I'm going to assume it's Fry. And Christina asks, are you finally ready to admit that Reylo is about to be a thing? Haha. Thank you for what you do. I don't trust anyone else with the canon timeline. Thanks, Christina. I appreciate that. As far as your question goes, there's two words in the English language that I wish I could delete and never hear again and never have it uttered by human mouths. And that would be twerk, any form of twerk, twerking, twerked, to twerk, I don't give a crap, twerk, and Reylo. Those are the two words I wish to God I could delete from anybody's memory of ever existing. Reylo is not going to happen. At least not in the way you think it may happen. It's not going to end up being a love story. Now, do I know that for sure? No, but could Rey join Kylo and they kind of run off together and be, you know, master and apprentice kind of thing? Possibly, but that doesn't mean they're going to be involved romantically. In The Force Awakens, she looked Kylo Ren in the eye and said, "You are a monster. You're a monster." She said that. Okay, she said this to the same man that she had just watched kill the only father figure. I've been doing this a lot tonight. The only father figure she ever knew, Han Solo. He was involved in blowing up the New Republic with Starkiller Base. He tried torturing her and that didn't work. But she told him, "You're a monster." Nobody comes back from that in one movie. Okay, now if we were talking 3 or 4 movies down the line, maybe, you know, there might be a chance that something like that could happen. But we are one movie removed from that. There's no way. There's no way Reylo is ever going to happen. Not romantically, at least. Here's the thing, though. If they do Reylo, I'm going to be doing that all night. I just know it. If they do Reylo, I'm going to literally lose all faith in the episodic films for this trilogy. I just am. We're already getting a love interest. I guarantee you. I promise you. Take this to the grave. Go to the bank with it. I don't care. I guarantee you our love story in this one, in this particular film, 8, Last Jedi, is going to be between Finn and Rose. That's my prediction. No, I don't know that to be true. That's what it's going to be. Finn and Rose are going to get together. That's going to be the love story. And besides, if you look at the novelization for The Force Awakens, at the end of it, they've already kind of alluded to Poe and Rey kind of having a thing. And I would be more okay with that. I mean, really, I would. It's just, we've already had this star-crossed lovers thing in the new canon, and it was in Lost Stars. If you haven't read Lost Stars by this point, you're not going to. Lost Stars, right? You have this couple that is in just unimaginable love with each other, and one side's on the Rebel Alliance, and one is on the Empire. That's your star-crossed lover story, okay? Do not do it with my Rey and my Kylo. Do not do that. It's going to be completely unnatural if you do it. And besides that, zero chemistry in Episode 7. There was no chemistry between them whatsoever. Now, granted, I do think something is going on between the two of them in Episode 8 based off of some of the footage we've seen in the trailer, which is in Snoke's throne room, I'm assuming, where she's facing Snoke and you see Kylo in the background. I think Kylo takes Rey to Snoke, but I don't think it's a, I don't think it's a lover situation, if you would. But thanks for the question. I do appreciate it. Thank you for being a follower, Christina. It's awesome to have you on board. Now, just as a tag on your question, you may be completely right. I could be completely wrong. It could happen. We're going to go see it, you know, in a week and a half. I could walk out and be like, well, crap, Christina was right, you know, so don't rule it out. So I'm not going to rule it out. I want to, but I can't yet. I don't want it to happen. Anyway, moving on. Question number four. And question number four comes from Casey Hall. And Casey asks, do you think we'll ever see a canon version of the Ujian Vong? Maybe we already have Snoke. Thanks for the question, Casey. It's entirely possible that Snoke could be a Ujian Vong. It's weird pronunciation for me. Coming from the guy that can't pronounce Thrawn's real name. Richard J. can do it, no problem. And he calls me a bloody redneck because I can't pronounce it. Sorry. But anyway, he's probably watching this right now. I'd be like, you are a bloody redneck. So I'm just going to call him the Vong. A version of the Vong maybe we already have. Now, I don't know a whole lot about the Vong. I know that they're from outside the Star Wars galaxy. I know they're immune to the Force. But from what I've read of them, they kind of feel like a cop-out to me in the EU. Now, I haven't read a whole... like, I've read maybe a third of the EU, and it got to the point I just couldn't keep up anymore, so I stopped reading. So, there's a lot that I haven't read. But in my opinion, I just feel like they're a cop-out. I mean, you've got this galaxy of billions and billions and billions of beings, and, you know, billions of stories going on. You couldn't find another villain somewhere in the Star Wars galaxy that would have been more interesting. You had to go outside the galaxy to find somebody and get beings that the Jedi couldn't use the Force on. Really? Really? That seems a bit of a cop-out to me, but I digress. Now, if Snoke is the canon version of the Vong, which is a very real possibility, that could happen, and I think I'd be all right with it. He's a Force user, so that means you're changing the lore of the Vong a little bit to where they're not outside the Force, and you're definitely changing the way they look, but I think I'd be alright with that. Now, they've already said Snoke's not human. They've already confirmed that he's not a human being, so it's possible. It really is, and they said he was there. You know, he saw the rise and fall of the Republic and the rise and fall of the Empire, which means he's older than we really can think right now. Of course, Maz was there for all of it, too. But Maz looks better for her age. Anyway, but it's entirely possible that Snoke could be a member of the Vong or a part of that species. That's entirely true. Do I think that's the way they're going to go? If I had to put money on it, I'd say no. But it's always a very real possibility. And if they did it, would I be all right with it? Yeah, I think I'd be all right with it. So, it's very, very possible. Now, I say Snoke's a Force user, but the only evidence we even have of him ever being a Force user is in the trailer for Episode 8 when Rey is kind of leaned back and it looks like her hair's blown in the wind and it looks like he's using the Force on her. Other than that, we don't know that Snoke's a Force user. It's never really been mentioned. If you think about it, just because he's teaching Kylo Ren the dark side doesn't mean he uses the dark side. You can be book smart, you know what I mean? But I think he's a Force user, I'm just saying. But yeah, anyway, I don't think, if Snoke's not a Vong, do I think we'll ever see a version of it? I'm going to say no. I don't think we're going to. I think once this trilogy's done, once we start getting some new canon material, and I think once this trilogy's done, instead of going forward in time anymore, I think they're going to go back to Old Republic time. I really think that that's the direction. That's what they've got their eye on at this point, especially for that live-action television series that's going to be on this Disney streaming service. I think they're going to go back in time instead of forward in time. So, is it a possibility? Anything's possible. But do I think it's going to happen? I doubt it very seriously. But thanks for the question, Casey. I do appreciate it. Let's see here. Question number five, if I can find it. Here we go. Question number five. And number five comes from Omar Gonzalez. And Omar asks, you mentioned Shadows of the Empire on your first mailbag episode. That was my favorite EU Legends novel ever. Is there any possibility that it could still be canon? Thanks. As much as I wish it was, and I hate to be the one to tell you this, There's already another novel in that placeholder that null and voids Shadows of the Empire, and it's called Moving Target. It's actually a Princess Leia novel. Takes place, for those of you that don't know, Shadows of the Empire happened before Empire Strikes Back and Return of the Jedi. Had a lot to do with Leia and Chewie and Lando trying to hunt down Boba Fett to get Han back. Dealt with Luke dealing with the fact that Vader was his father. And it introduced this new aspect of the story, the Black Sun, led by Prince Xizor, who was a Fallen, who was trying to get to Skywalker before Vader did, because they were kind of his nemesis, right? And great novel, it really was. If they had made it canon, I'd have been perfectly happy with it. But now we have a novel called Moving Target, which takes place during that time period, and it officially null and void Shadows of the Empire. It's about Leia. She's kind of mourning that Han's not there anymore. They haven't gone to look for him yet, but Mon Mothma comes to her and tells her, look, if you do this mission, we'll put together a rescue team to go find General Solo, or Captain Solo. And so she goes on this mission to kind of, I don't want to give too much away if you haven't read it. They kind of go on this mission to distract the Empire away from the Rebel fleet massing to go assault the second Death Star. But now we know from Battlefront 2 that the Empire already knew about the fleet amassing. So this book was kind of just pissing in the wind, to be honest. But it was the first book that came out that I read that I started to realize that they were going, because it came out before Force Awakens. And it was the first book that came out that I started to realize that they were going for a moral gray area between the Rebel Alliance and the Empire. And what I mean by that is that it was no longer cut and dry, black and white, good and bad. It was the Rebel Alliance doing what had to be done for the greater good, which in the form of sacrificing, possibly sacrificing other civilians to keep the Empire off of their back to attack the second Death Star, which is really dark when you think about it, but it was a good read. I mean, it's short enough. You can read it in 2.5-3 hours, something like that, but and it's the only novel, it's the only thing that takes place between those films. So are they planning on doing something more in between there? I don't know. I would be nice if they did, but there's no mention of Prince Xizor. I mean, it's a completely different story than what Shadows of the Empire was. Was it as good as Shadows of the Empire? No. Is it worth the read? Yes. So take that with a grain of salt. Take that as you will. And believe me, and I'm assuming by your question you meant, is it just not canon yet and it could be somewhere down the road? Kind of like my favorite trilogy is the Bane trilogy in the EU, which those could be canon. We just don't know if they are or not. They haven't officially made it canon. We know the characters, but we don't know that those stories are. So I'm assuming that's what you were talking about. But if they'd have come out and said Shadows of the Empire was going to be carried over as canon, I'd have been perfectly happy with it. Absolutely perfectly happy. So I stand by you. We need justice for Shadows of the Empire. Thanks for the question, Omar. Appreciate it. And the last question of the night, number 6, comes from Ashton Bowen. Bowen? I think it's Bowen. Guys, I'm no good with names, so if I butcher it, I'm truly, truly sorry. And Ashton wants to know, is it absolutely required to read Inferno Squad before playing Battlefront 2? I wasn't a fan of how they treated Catalyst in Rogue One that way. Love your channel. Thanks, Ashton. I appreciate it. Alright, so for those of you that don't know what she's referring to, Catalyst in Rogue One, Catalyst was a novel that came out, and it was the prequel novel to Rogue One, A Star Wars Story. And it started during the Clone Wars and kind of led up to the moment Rogue One picks up, right? And it showed the relationship between Krennic and Galen and, you know, how Lyra was, you know, because in Rogue One, Krennic says, oh, Lyra, as troublesome as ever. You see why he says that. She got in the way of a lot of his plans in the novel and stuff like that, of trying to get Galen to work on this project, the Death Star, right? There I go again. They didn't call it the Death Star in the book. But you see, like, Jen is born in the book. You see the end of the Clone Wars in the book, stuff like that. But what they did was, like, I read Catalyst before going to see Rogue One for the first time. And during that opening scene, I knew what was going on instantly. I instantly knew what planet we were going to. I knew the name of the planet. I knew what the situation was. I knew whose shuttle that was coming in. I knew what was about to happen. And then when they started talking, I knew the situation. It's like, because I finished reading the book like 2 days before the movie came out. So it's just a continuation of what I had read. And I felt like I already knew these characters. They'd already been developed so well, right? And I thought it was a really good segue between the novels and the films. And, like, I read it, and then I went with a friend of ours to see it, and they hadn't read Catalyst before they saw the movie, but they still got what was going on from context clues, right? Kirsty, she listened to the audiobook before she went and saw it, so she knew what was going on. But for those people that didn't read Catalyst before seeing Rogue One, you can still figure out what was going on with context clues. You just didn't have all the details. You know what I mean? And we all know Rogue One didn't have an opening crawl, and I call Catalyst the opening crawl for Rogue One, just a 400-page opening crawl for Rogue One. So that's what she's referring to as far as Catalyst and Rogue One goes. Did they handle that properly? I don't think so, because afterwards I can't help but feel like you really do need to read Catalyst before going to see Rogue One. Not because you don't know what's going on in the film, but because it enhances it so much. I feel like anybody who, if you're going to, at this point, anybody who's going to care about the movie enough to want to read a novel first has already seen the movie. But yeah, they should have put out Catalyst after Rogue One. I really think Catalyst should have come out after Rogue One. But I digress. That's just what, that's my opinion. Now, about your question, is it absolutely required to read Inferno Squad? No, it's not. It's the same kind of situation as Inferno Squad, or as Catalyst and Rogue One, but just not to the same extreme. They really don't refer to a whole lot in the game that has to do with the book. Not, I mean, hardly at all, but you get to know the characters a lot better before you get into the game, because I read Inferno Squad, I finished it months ago, and then played the game like 2 weeks ago for the first time. And these characters were characters that I'd already known from going on their first few missions with them, and you know, through the novel, and I knew these characters. I knew what to expect out of them. Do you have to? I'm going to say no. But does it help? Hell yes, it helps. And Inferno Squad's a great novel, by the way. If you have the game and you haven't played it yet, and you're willing to actually invest yourself in some story before you play the game, no matter how bad you want to play it right now, before you play the game, read the book. I promise you, it's not going to be one of those that you drag through. You can read it in a day if you just wanted to. It's not one that's going to drag. It's a really, really good book. It's hard to put down. Trust me, it's worth reading the book. You're not even going to be thinking about playing the game while you're reading this book. I mean, the book is that good. So, is it necessary? Is it absolutely required? No, it's not, but it sure as hell helps. And it does make it a very cool experience to actually read these characters and then you play as them, because then you start to see why certain people act a certain way around each other and stuff like that. And it's really, really, really cool. Considering we haven't got the whole campaign for Battlefront 2 yet, they're still going to release another part of it after The Last Jedi releases. So you've got time to sit down and read Inferno Squad. That way, whenever the new piece of the campaign comes out, you can just sit down and play the campaign all the way through. So I hope that answers your question. That's just me personally. But yeah, and love your channel. Thank you, Ashton. I really do appreciate that. Guys, this channel would not be what it is without you guys. And yes, I'm going to call it quits for the night. I don't know, I've only been recording for 20, 23 minutes, something like that. But like I said, I'm not feeling real good. Guys, this channel wouldn't be anything without you guys. It's already more than I ever thought it would be. And I mean, it's nothing compared to other YouTube channels, but I don't care. Like I said on last week's mailbag, I'm not after the most subscribers, I'm after the best subscribers. And if you guys are subscribed, you are part of those best subscribers. So without you guys, this channel wouldn't be anything, and I thank you guys for that. But that does it for this week's episode of Mailbag. Like I said, if you guys want to get your question on, just email us at StarWarsCanonLibrary@gmail.com, and we'll get your question on, if possible. There were probably a dozen and a half that I couldn't get on this episode. So you could try again, and it, you know, if there happens to be a week where there are lulls, there's no question. Questions can carry over. So I've already got another one for next week for Richard J as well. So yeah, guys, that'll do it for this episode. Make sure to check out the website also to StarWarsCanonLibrary.com. You can like us on Facebook. There's a lot of live Q&As that I do on there, and mainly for the Facebook followers. We also have a discussion group on there. You can talk about any Star Wars subject whatsoever without anybody really ridiculing you or putting you down for your opinion. If you guys like this video, make sure to hit that thumbs up button. If you really like it, hit that subscribe button. I would really, really appreciate it. And guys, until next time, this is Brian signing off. May the Force be with you. Hey guys, make sure to check out the website. It is www.starwarscanonlibrary.com. You can email us anytime with any questions for any Star Wars canon material whatsoever. It's just starwarscanonlibrary@gmail.com. Make sure to check out our Facebook page as well. It is facebook.com/starwarscanonlibrary. If you guys like this video, make sure to hit that thumbs up button. There's plenty more videos coming where this one came from. If you really liked it, make sure to hit that subscribe button. I'd sure appreciate it.